Welcome to the Transform Our World podcast with Ed Silvoso. Ecclesia, everyone, every day, everywhere.
In this journey, we are going to have setbacks. Don't be afraid of that. I'd rather get out of the boat and sink, knowing that Jesus will pick me up and I will walk on water with Jesus and get back in the boat and the storm will stop, rather than be afraid to try. So let me show from the scriptures. Paul suffered two major setbacks, actually very painful setbacks, but God turned those setbacks into setups to major victories. Look at the screen there. The numbers there symbolize, represent the chapters number in the book of Acts, in chapter 13 all the way to chapter 19. The first setback happened in Pisidia of Antioch. Look at this. Nearly the whole city, was hearing the voice of God. The whole region was being rocketed by the gospel. But the reaction, instigated by the devil, I'm sure, is that women of prominence and leading men of the city instigated the persecution against Paul and Barnabas. And as a result of that, in spite of the revival that was rocking the region, they were driven out of their district. What a tragedy. Second setback is in Thessalonica. Look how the Bible explains. It says that there was a great multitude of God-fearing Greeks and a number of leading women. That was a huge revival. But wicked men from the marketplace, they form a mob and they set the city in an uproar and they stir up the crowd and the city authorities. And again, they have to send Paul and his companion away by night. Two major setbacks. But now we go to the victories. The first one is in Corinth. It says that many of the Corinthians, when they heard, they were believing, they were being baptized. It was a people movement. So extraordinary that God, as you may recall, had to come in a vision by night to reassure Paul. But the reaction was the same. It says that the Jews, in one accord, rose up against Paul and brought him before the judgment seat. Basically, they took him to court. And what happened there? I love what happened. The proconsul, which is the equivalent of the presiding judge, threw the case out. He drove the Jews away from the judgment seat. And as a result, Paul, rather than fleeing by night like before, he remained there many days. Now we go to the next example in Ephesus. The word of the Lord was growing mightily and prevailing, but there arose no small disturbance, and the city was filled with confusion, and they rushed Paul's associates into the theater, and most likely they were going to kill them. Paul wasn't there, but he wanted to get there. And look at what happens there. The Asiarchs, who were the governors of Asia, they are described as Paul's friends. They urge him not to venture into the theater. Basically, the implication is, we'll take care of that. I don't know what they did, but they got the word to the presiding magistrate, and after quieting the multitude, the town clerk dismissed the assembly. On one hand, you have two defeats in Pisidia of Antioch and Thessalonica, and two victories. Why the defeats and why the victories? And listen, this is the key. This is the key to transformation. Where Paul suffered defeats is because his public identity was solely religious. But in the other two cities, to his religious message, to his religious identity, he added a marketplace presence. And as a result of that, the people in authority, the Asiarchs, the governors of Asia, they were not afraid to be known as Paul's friends. And now the question is, why did they defend him? Listen carefully, because Paul was an asset, not only to the congregation that he planted, not only to the church that he was presiding over, but listen carefully, he was an asset to the region. The government needed Paul, needed the ecclesia. How did he become an asset? Well, this is explained in chapter 20. I mean, there Paul is telling his disciples, you yourself know that these hands, these are the hands through which God performed extraordinary miracles, where Paul was making money, okay, by building tents. They ministered to my own needs and also to the needs of those that were with me. And then I taught you, he's telling his disciples, that in everything, by working hard, okay, in this manner, you must help the needy. And when you do that, it's because you remember the words of the Lord Jesus, who says, it is more blessed to give than to receive. So look at that, working hard in the marketplace, but ministering while you're working there, prospering so you can help the needy, and now you look like Jesus, who was a giver and not a taker. My friend, the whole creation is eagerly awaiting the manifestation of the children of God. What we have going on inside the church building is marvelous. The miracles, the signs, the restoration, the deliverance, the prosperity. But the whole world is eagerly waiting for this to be manifested out there. And when it does, mayors, school principals, people in authority, law enforcement people, they testify. And many of them come to the Lord.
Thank you for listening to today's edition of the Transform Our World podcast with Ed Silvoso. Ecclesia everyone, every day, everywhere. We invite you to make your own home in Ecclesia, a place where the presence and power of the Lord Jesus dwells every day. Then visit us at transformourworld.org or Ecclesia Everywhere on Facebook to join a massive movement of believers who are changing our world for the better. Because it really is God's time for you, your family, your neighborhood, and nation.